Details of the next few years of the young Crowley's life vary from biography to biography, but it was clear that there was no love lost between mother and son. The pious Emily Crowley was undoubtedly concerned over the ungodly behaviour of her son, and would on many occasions call him a beast. The young Crowley revelled in this new accolade, and began to identify himself with the beast from the Book of Revelation, whose number is the number of a man, 666, 666. His mother, on the other hand, believed in the literal truth of the Bible and would not have used this term lightly. It is clear that however much he rejected it, she probably foresaw the destiny of her wayward son.
My mother actually believed that I was the Antichrist of the Apocalypse. And yet, she also believed that her poor, lost, erring son might yet repent and be redeemed by the precious blood.
Just after his father's death in 1887, Emily moved the family from Red Hill to Thistlegrove in London to stay with her brother Tom Bond Bishop. Bishop did not believe the accusations made against Crowley by the Reverend Champney, and much to Crowley's delight, moved him away from the school. Bishop also recognised that the young Crowley's health was poor, and a doctor confirmed his fears when he diagnosed that Crowley would be unlikely to reach manhood. Bishop decided to keep the boy at home and embarked upon employing a succession of private tutors over the next 2 years. He also resolved that the boy's recovery required plenty of open-air exercise, including fishing and mountain climbing. Again, this delighted Crowley. Crowley progressed rapidly in mathematics, English literature, Greek and Latin, and welcomed the freedom he had been granted in being able to read books which had previously been denied him. He became adept in poetry and developed a yearning to become a great poet. Among the tutors that emerged, one Archibald Douglas taught Crowley not only English and maths, however, he also introduced him to the vices of racing, billiards, betting, cards, and on a trip to Torquay with Douglas, he was also introduced to the vices of women. It was on this trip at the age of 15 when Crowley lost his virginity to a woman he met in the theatre.
The nightmare world of Christianity vanished at the dawn. The obsession of sin fell from my shoulders into a sea of oblivion. It was a period of boundless happiness for me.
Whilst being introduced to the sins of the flesh may have instigated a period of happiness for Crowley, it certainly had the reverse effect on his mother. No more so than when she discovered that whilst the family was away, Crowley had experimented further with a young parlour maid in his mother's bed. The maid was dismissed and put out on the streets, and according to Crowley, she changed her name and became a prostitute. He also claimed that she met a fateful demise at the hands of no other than Jack the Ripper. In later years, Alistair Crowley would publish an article claiming that he had discovered the actual identity of Jack the Ripper, one Robert Dunstan, a black magician. Crowley claimed to a member of the press that he had in fact met with Dunstan prior to his death in 1912, and that Dunstan had given him 5 blood-soaked ties, corresponding to the 5 murders committed in Whitechapel. How much truth can be held in these claims is debatable. But one thing that can be claimed for sure is these were just 2 of the many sinister and strange coincidences that were to surround this iniquitous man for the rest of his life and beyond.
Well, after the business with the parlour maid, we sent him off to Malvern Public School. But after only 3 terms, he came home with claims of being the victim of sexual abominations from other boys. My sister Emily, of course, refused to send him back, and instead we found him a place at Tunbridge. He seemed happy there. He spent the summer fishing and climbing, and indeed he had regained his physical health. His moral well-being, however, was a different story. After being at Tunbridge for less than a year, he went on a trip to Glasgow and ended up contracting a sexual disease from a prostitute. Of course, in disgrace, he was asked to leave the school. We then sent to live with a brethren tutor in Eastbourne, where he attended day classes at the local school. This seemed more productive. In fact, his studies improved. He took up chess and excelled, winning many local championships. He had also become quite a proficient rock climber. One of his favourite spots was Beachy Head, where he spent many days and nights camping and climbing. I think it was in 1894 when he joined the Scottish Mountaineering Club and went on his first trip to the Alps.
In 1895, at the age of 20, the affluent Crowley went to Trinity College, Cambridge, to read moral sciences, taking rooms at No. 16 St. John Street. It was also at this time that he decided to change his name from Edward to Alistair. He spent little time in the lecture halls and did most of his studying of English literature in his rooms, where he amassed a vast collection of books. He seldom ventured out of his rooms, other than to indulge in his love of chess. In his first year, he joined the University Chess Club, where he promptly triumphed over the club president. In the summer of 1895, he spent his vacation in the Alps, conquering a sole ascent of the Eiger. Crowley studied Russian and spent much of his vacation the following summer travelling through Europe and on to St. Petersburg, as well as his favourite sojourn in the Alps. In the winter holidays of his second year at Cambridge, Crowley visited Stockholm, and it was there on New Year's Eve 1897 that something happened to Alistair Crowley that would set the course of his life forever. It was approaching midnight, and he was asleep in his hotel room.
I was asleep, and yet I was awake. But this wasn't a dream. I became astutely aware that I possessed a magical means of becoming conscious of something inside me. I could release a side to my nature that I didn't know existed. It was a painful, terrifying, and horrific experience, and yet, at the same time, it seemed to be the answer. It seemed so pure and spiritual. My path had been chosen.